A right-wing reckoning on social media. On Friday, Twitter permanently banned President Trump from its platform for inciting this week's insurrection. And just breaking tonight, Amazon will remove Parler from its cloud hosting service tomorrow, effectively kicking the app off the public internet until it finds a new host. Parler, a so-called, quote, unbiased social media platform that is popular with the right, was also removed from Apple App Store today as well. And my next guest was an early Facebook investor and former advisor to Mark Zuckerberg, and he's now committed to reforming the tech giants. Roger McNamee joins me now. Roger, thanks for coming on. You're also the author, we should mention, of Zucked, Waking Up to the Facebook Catastrophe. Roger, let's start with Twitter. We've learned that Trump is now planning to lean into his fight with big tech in his final days as president. What do you think of Twitter's move?
So, Pamela, I think the key thing to keep in mind is that inciting insurrection against one of the branches of government, in this case, the Congress, at an event where the vice president and the next two people in the chain of succession to the president were all in attendance, a violent insurrection, that is the greatest crime any president could possibly commit. I mean, in the old days, it almost certainly would have been a capital crime. So the notion that we're focused on what he's saying about Twitter, in my mind, is actually misplaced. This could not be a more serious offense if it tried. And I think Twitter banning Trump is literally the bare minimum that they could have done. And these other tech giants taking action against the enablers of what Trump did here is literally the bare minimum. Our democracy is hanging on by a thread, and internet platforms have played a huge role in putting us here. And it's really long past time for them to take responsibility and begin to behave as good corporate citizens.
What do you say to critics of Twitter's move? You had Mike Pompeo, Nikki Haley, many others, particularly on the right, who have been critical of it, saying this is something we'd expect to see in China, not in the United States. What do you have to say to all the criticism about this and that there is authoritarian regime leaders who are still on Twitter and yet you would kick off President Trump? What is your response to them?
It's a very simple one. Let's keep in mind that the president of the United States and all of those people you just mentioned have been enablers of denial of a COVID pandemic that has now killed nearly 370,000 Americans, which the ratio of that is so much higher as a percentage of our population than any other developed country in the world. I mean, it's literally like 10 times as bad as other developed countries. And so these internet platforms have enabled the disinformation that undermined our pandemic response. And again, I think this was, you know, this isn't about politics left or right. This is about public safety and public health. And I just think the internet platforms have behaved horribly. And quite candidly, the Trump administration, all the people in it, and the media companies around them have been enablers of this massive, essentially death cult against American people. And I'm deeply, deeply troubled because we're sitting there arguing about whether this is about freedom of speech when in fact, you know, hundreds of thousands of Americans are needlessly dead.
So then do you think that they should have banned earlier then?
Oh, much earlier. And I mean, the issue here is I believe that when we have the accounting here, we're going to see that the business model that powers YouTube, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, and other parts of Google and other platforms, that surveillance capitalism, that business model is just incompatible with democracy and it's incompatible with public health. And I just believe that as a country, we're facing a moment of reckoning right now where we have to decide what matters to us. Are we going to be a democracy? Are we going to be capitalist? Are we going to have opportunity for everyone? Are we going to treat everyone with respect? Because that has not been the track record of the past 4 years. And the country, I mean, we've barely survived the last 4 years. And it's not clear that we're out of the woods here.
You were at Facebook during the early days. Were there discussions then about how this could happen, how something like this could happen, how it could be used as a platform to perpetuate disinformation like this and essentially evil?
So I was only involved with Mark Zuckerberg as an advisor from 2006 to 2009. Mark was 22 when I first started working with him. The company was tiny. So it, you know, it couldn't even dream of being global on the days that I was involved with it. So the answer is no. All of this came as a huge shock to me. It was my expectation that as Mark grew up and as the company got bigger, he would do what most executives do, which is to embrace success and become a good corporate citizen and work really hard to integrate with society and to be a constructive partner in it. And, you know, the reality is the culture of business in America is broken. We have monopolies in almost every industry. They are authoritarian by nature, and they have not, I don't, in any sector of the country have we seen the kind of civic-minded corporate leadership that we used to see a generation or two ago. And I think that's one of the things that we're going to have to settle going forward, because authoritarian business, which is what we've had in this country, leads to authoritarian government. And, you know, I think we're seeing what that looks like now, and I hope that people are saying, we don't like that. We want to become the America that is a shining symbol of freedom and equality of opportunity, and, you know, that we have a capitalist system that encourages innovation and, you know, making people's lives better instead of worse.
Lastly, how do you envision Facebook and other social media platforms paying for their role, essentially, in the insurrection? As you have said, you think that they should pay a price. What should that be?
So, you know, Pamela, this is a really important point. There are three areas of regulation we need to see as soon as possible. We need to see regulation around safety. These companies have to be accountable for harm. They have to have incentives to anticipate and prevent harms, the way you would see, you know, in the chemicals industry or in the building trades, where people really are personally accountable and have to do the right thing all the time. We have to see rules around privacy to protect people from having their lives manipulated without their ability to control it. And then lastly, we need to restore competition. We need to get away from monopoly, back to capitalism, and have the tech industry be a growth engine for the economy again, because that's not where we are today. We need it creating jobs. And, you know, it's a great opportunity, Pamela, and I hope we seize it.
All right. Roger, thank you so much. Appreciate it.